John, thank you very much indeed. And a fascinating subject for us this evening. Nuclear energy must power our future. Fascinating because we are in the middle of a general election campaign. And I took the liberty of going through the manifestos of the three main parties. There is no mention of the words nuclear energy or nuclear power in the manifestos of either the Conservative or the Labour Party. And there is three lines and one word in the manifesto of the Liberal Party. Now, I'm not quite sure how you interpret that, but one clear interpretation is that none of the major parties in Britain are prepared to take the lead in the debate on the building of new nuclear power stations. At least they are not prepared to do so in the course of an election campaign. But there are a lot of energy experts, including people close to number 10, who actually say that the issue has got to be raised within months of whoever wins the next general election. And it has to be raised because they argue that Britain would have to start construction of new plants to meet its power production and climate targets. But as I say, the parties do not believe that the next government will have a responsibility to promote the nuclear argument. Labour and the Conservatives say it's down to industry to make a case which the government will then consider, while the Lib Dems think that the whole argument is completely unwinnable anyway. Now, just to set it in context before we start, let's look at the situation on nuclear power in Britain briefly. Britain's 12 nuclear power stations currently provide a little over 20% of the nation's electricity. The last station to come on stream was Sizewell B in 1994 after one of the biggest public inquiries ever undertaken in Britain. And unless the aging stations are replaced with new ones, there are likely to be only three left operating by the year 2020, producing perhaps just 7% of the country's requirements. Lord May, the outgoing president of the Royal Society, the UK's Academy of Science, recently called for a public debate on nuclear new build, arguing that the dangers of climate change demanded an urgent move away from fossil fuels and their carbon dioxide emissions. Well, you won't get that debate from the politicians during the election campaign. You will get it here tonight, courtesy of Intelligence Squared. Our first speaker is Bruno Combi. Bruno is the founder and current president of the Association of Environmentalists for Nuclear Energy, or EFN. He's a postgraduate in nuclear physics from the National University of Advanced Technology in Paris. And in 2001, he founded the splendidly titled Optimistic Movement, of which he is president. He devotes his life to independent scientific research and teaching in the fields of environmental protection and healthy living for all citizens of the planet, which includes no smoking, better nutrition, proteins for the third world, energy, and the environment. He's written 10 books on health and environmental subjects, which are known worldwide, including the bestseller, Environmentalists for Nuclear Energy. It was published here in 2001, but of course has been translated into many languages and used as the basis for several items on various media outlets right across the world. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Bruno Combi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. Some environmental groups, such as Greenpeace, are opposed to nuclear energy. But in fact, there are very good reasons, environmental reasons, to be in favor of nuclear energy. And a growing number of scientists and environmentalists today, such as Professor James Lovelock, my good friend, and Bishop Hugh Montefiore, which is with us here tonight, support nuclear energy for its environmental reasons, especially to counter climate change. First, let me say a few words to let you understand where I come from. My father was an oil exploration geologist, and so I grew up in close contact with nature. Because oil fields are remote and quickly exhausted, we moved every few years. And I lived in France, but also in Africa, Canada, United States, and various countries. By traveling in these different places, I had very young a global view of our planet and of some simple energy problems. My military service then took me over to the Persian Gulf, where I served as a deck officer on the French Navy. Our mission was to protect the oil supertankers navigating through the Hormuz Strait. This was at the time of the first Iran-Iraq war in 1981. And I learned there how fragile our supply of oil can be. After my university studies, I decided to devote my life to the protection of the environment and better lifestyle. I became an independent scientist and researcher and traveled around the books to talk about how to stop smoking, eat better natural foods, and adopt a better lifestyle. About energy, today 20% of the world population consumes 60% of the energy. This situation is very unfair and fortunately is bound to change. Developing countries such as China, India, Brazil, or Southeast Asia are already beginning to consume huge amounts of energy, almost plus 10% last year just for China. The world population has increased already by a factor of 4 in the last 150 years and will perhaps stabilize at about 10 billion inhabitants in 2050, hopefully. This also contributes to a sharp rise, unfortunately, in energy consumption with possibly devastating effects on our atmosphere. A citizen of India or Bangladesh today consumes 20 times less energy than an American citizen and 10 times less energy than a British citizen. Humanity today produces its energy with 7% hydro, 7% nuclear, but 85% fossil fuels, which generate 3 million tons per hour of carbon dioxide, which is poured directly into the atmosphere. This represents 800 tons every second. Since I started this presentation about 2 minutes ago, mankind has added an additional 100,000 tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. The total of wind, geothermal, and solar energy today represents less than 1% of the world's energy production. Also today, in 2004, we are now facing the third world oil shock, with prices running close to $60 per barrel of oil. The problem in the future, however, is not only about the price of oil. We are now reaching what is called the oil production peak in England, but also very soon at world level. Abundant and cheap oil is part of the past. In the coming years, entire portions of the planet will simply be deprived from oil as the production starts to decline while the demand continues to grow. Great tension will then appear for the control of the last oil fields. What we are seeing today in Iraq is only the beginning of what is to come. These tons of oil we are taking from the inside of the earth, we are throwing into the atmosphere. The greenhouse gas effect is the biggest environmental challenge which humanity has to tackle. Our planet is warming up. It has already warmed up by almost 1 degree in the 20th century and is expected to warm up by a further 3 to 10 degrees Celsius in the 21st century. Now, if mankind suddenly stopped by magic all emissions, due to the long carbon cycle in the atmosphere, the climate will continue to warm up during several centuries. Not many people are aware of this time lag. It implies, of course, that we are already in the soup. We have ignited a climatic time bomb. And we can only hope that it is not too late. Urgent action is necessary. We are burning in 50 years the oil that nature has taken 100 million years to accumulate. If we wanted this to be sustainable, we need 2 million planets like the Earth. The top priority today is to urgently stop burning all fossil fuels, gas, oil, and coal. We are lucky that a solution exists, as we will see. But what solutions? Wind energy can help. but it is very dilute and available only when the wind blows. The most modern windmills are about 2 to 3 megawatts, and they are as high, twice as high, as Notre Dame, the Cathedral of Paris. To produce as much as one modern nuclear reactor, you need to line them up all the way from Genova in Italy to Barcelona in Spain. 3 per kilometer. You have to respect a 300-meter space between each of them, and they are 150 meters wide. This, of course, would not be very good for the environment. Solar energy can also help, and it should be developed, especially for hot water production. A few square meters of solar panels on the roof of houses can produce about 2/3 of domestic hot water on a normal flat. Solar cooking can also be encouraged, especially in areas such as India or Africa. But solar energy cannot come close to produce the amounts of energy necessary to fuel our modern civilization, even as we should do if we put energy efficiency as a top priority. Another major energy source is needed. Now let's come to nuclear. A nuclear reactor is very compact, produces high amounts of energy, and occupies only a small area of land. Although uranium is not entirely renewable, it is sustainable in the long term. Compared to fossil fuels, nuclear energy gains a factor of 1 million. 1 gram of uranium or plutonium will produce as much energy as 1 ton of oil, coal, or gas. That's a factor 1 million. Therefore, just a few uranium mines are enough to produce a lot of energy on the planet compared to hundreds of thousands of oil wells today. With uranium on its own territory, a country like France has as much energy resource for the future as the entire oil wells of a country like Saudi Arabia. The amount of nuclear waste which is produced in accordingly small amounts by a factor of 1 million compared to the fossil fuels. So the volume of nuclear waste is very small, and it can be therefore easily confined, which is the case, reprocessed, and safely deposited. These nuclear waste also decompose with time. That's the definition of radioactivity. A radioactive element disintegrates after a certain amount of time. Therefore, it does not remain toxic forever, like chemical waste, which we produce in much greater quantities. Nuclear power today is available. It produces only very small amounts of very well-confined waste, and it does not contribute to global warming. This is the reason to better inform the public why I created EFN, the Association of Environmentalists for Nuclear Energy, which gathers today over 7,000 members and supporters in 53 countries. For more information, you can refer to our website. And this is why, yes, I consider as an environmentalist that nuclear energy must absolutely power our future. Thank you very much.
Bruno, thank you very much for starting off the proposing of the motion for us. Opposing the motion now, we have Michael Schneider. Michael works as an independent international energy consultant and science writer. Between 1983 and April 2003, he was executive director of the Energy Information Service, WISE, in Paris, and chief editor of the web-based Plutonium Investigation. He has been an advisor to the French Environment Minister's Office and to the Belgian Minister for Energy and Sustainable Development. He's also been a consultant on nuclear issues to the German Environment Ministry, a job he still holds, and has provided consultation to a wide variety of clients, including the International Atomic Energy Agency, Greenpeace International, and the European Commission. In 1997, he was honored with the Right Livelihood Award, which is an alternative Nobel Prize, along with Shinzaburo Takagi, for their work on plutonium issues. Michael Schneider.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I will try to give you an overview of the history of the nuclear programs in the world and what kind of trends we can identify from that history. I think it's a lot of times in debates very useful to agree first on a certain number of underlying facts, and then we can, you know, everybody can discuss opinions. But it's absolutely fundamental to have the basics on which we can all agree. So what we see here is the history of nuclear power plants. You see the numbers in the bars. You can see that the program basically in the world went up until the end of the 1980s, and since then has sort of flattened out. Like there's no significant increase. The line which is drawn in gives you the development of the installed capacity, electricity generating capacity. Now, if you take the same picture for the European Union, you get this result. As you can see, we already reached an absolute number of 172 in 1989. And since then, there has been a net decline of operating nuclear reactors in the European Union of 22 units. So currently there are 150 reactors operating. So we had a continuous net decline over the last 15 years. If you look at the electricity production worldwide by nuclear reactors, you realize that it's in total 31 countries that produce nuclear electricity, that operate nuclear reactors. That's roughly 15% of the member states of the UN. So it's a rather small portion. Furthermore, it is not stretched out like a balanced operation of reactors. The numbers are very much concentrated, and so is the production of nuclear electricity. Like the big six, United States, France, Japan, Germany, Russia and South Korea produce together 3/4 of the nuclear electricity in the world, 3/4 by 6 countries, and the rest is shared by all the other countries together. Also, one should add that we have a very particular situation in Europe. I'm from France, and you've all heard about the famous French nuclear program. In fact, France produces today 45%, so close to half of all nuclear electricity in the European Union. So it really is a very particular and exceptional case. Now, this graph shows you the average age of operating reactors. Like, currently the age is close to 22 years on average. And as you can see, it's most of the units are really around the 20-year age line. If you look, on the other hand, the age of already shutdown reactors, like reactors that have reached the end of their operating lifetime, it's by coincidence, currently almost the same figure. Like it's close to 21 years. On average, and it's 108 reactors that have been shut down. The thing which should be stressed is that, as you can see, there's only a very small number of reactors that have actually reached 30 years operating life or longer. In fact, half of them are UK reactors. They're the old generation military production reactors. So they're by no means comparable to reactors that are the large reactors that are currently operating. So the industrial experience of long-living reactors is extremely small currently. Now, this looks a little wild, but it's actually fairly simple to understand. We have considered, based on industry estimates that say operating lifetimes can reach 40 years, we have said this seems very optimistic considering the lack of industrial experience, and it's roughly almost doubling the operating lifetime as it currently stands. So it seems quite optimistic. We considered this hypothesis of 40 years lifetime, and we looked, taking into account the reactors that are currently under construction and have a fixed time schedule to start up, we have looked how many reactors will reach when the 40-year operating lifetime. So if you basically can see that more and more reactors will be taken out of the would be taken out of the program if they were shut down at the age 40. Again, the current experience of all shutdown reactors is an average age of 21 years. So 40 years seems already very, very optimistic. So 80 reactors roughly reach the age of 40 over the next 10 years, 80 units in the world. Another close to 200 reactors reach age 40 the following 10 years. In fact, until 2020, the number is 167 units reaching age 40. Now, those are numbers which you have to put facing the industrial capacity and what is called lead times, like the time from, let's say, a political decision, an industrial decision, an energy policy decision to build a nuclear reactor to the actual starting up of a unit. To give you an idea, the last US-built reactor that came online was under construction for 23 years. That's probably not such a good example, but it happens. The last French reactor that came online was under construction for 8.5 years, and it took over 11 years to reach commercial operation. This gives you an idea of the time frames that are involved. In other words, it is industrially strictly impossible to plan, build, and start up nuclear reactors in that range, like 80 units over the next 10 years, 167 over the next 15 years, or, 280 reactors over the next 20 years. Now, if that's the case, then we're confronted with two possibilities. Either the nuclear industry will face a steady, slow decline, or the average age of operating reactors has to be increased considerably. Now, I don't think that's a wonderful idea because it has a huge amount of implications, in particular for safety-related questions. So if we are faced with the industrial reality of a complete incapacity, which, by the way, has a lot of other criteria, of course. It's the industrial capacity to build. Interestingly enough, you might have heard that there is the only new project which is currently under construction is in Finland. It's called the European Pressurized Water Reactor. I wonder whether this is actually the correct name, because the key parts of the plant, which is the reactor pressure vessel and the steam generators, are actually built in Japan. So this is like a European-Japanese reactor rather than a European one. But if it's impossible industrially to build those facilities, it also means that the role nuclear power can play, which is currently, Bruno Combi has said it, it's around 6%. Tendency is falling. And final energy is something like 2 to 3%. So if it's industrially impossible to keep the same level, it also means that the implication for climate change will remain extremely small. And then one can argue, isn't it a huge waste of money to get into a technology that will never be able to come in considerably on the issue of climate change? Thank you for your attention.
Michael, thank you very much indeed. And we're now going to hear for the motion Bishop Hugh Montefiore. Now, the bishop was born in 1920. He served as a gunner officer in Burma during the last war. He was ordained a priest in the Church of England. He has been Bishop of Kingston, Bishop of Birmingham, as you know, from which he retired in 1987, and was formerly chairman of Transport 2000. He was a trustee of Friends of the Earth from 1984 to 2004. He has commendably the shortest CV of all our panelists. So without any more ado, let's hear from, for the motion, Bishop Hugh Montefiore.
Ladies and gentlemen, those who are against nuclear energy, in my judgment, are living in a time warp. They're living in the past, isolated from the realities of global warming. It's rather like death. They know it's coming, but prefer not to think about it. We are today on the edge of an abyss. That phrase isn't mine. It's taken from the March number of The New Scientist. And we were warned only last month by a conference convened by the government that the risks of climate change are more serious than had been thought. CO2 in the atmosphere has increased by over a third from pre-industrial levels. It stands now at 379 parts per million. It has increased by 2.5 parts per million in each of the last 2 years. When it reaches the threshold of 400, we are starting to reach the point of no return, irreversible change for some 10,000 years. And that, if you calculate, may be little more than a decade away. I'm speaking as a theologian, as an environmentalist of some 50 years. The position is critical. We must reduce CO2 by between 60 and 80% by 2050. Add to that, as you heard, that 20% of our electricity at present comes from nuclear reactors, which are due to be phased out, and demand for electricity is increasing 1% per annum. And then think of the huge industrial expansion in India and China, and that is the vastness of the challenge with which we are faced. And it is absolutely vital that we reach our goals, because this year we are leading the G8 nations, which produce most of the world's emissions. How can we convince other nations to do what we can't do ourselves? A quarter of CO2 emissions come from domestic use, and much can be saved there. An industry has already economized a lot, and doubtless it can do more. But transport is using more and more energy with more cars and growing air travel. Economies alone aren't anything like enough. We need as much help as we can get from renewable energy that is pollution-free. But it's not enough to close that gap. I hope it may be one day. But don't be deceived by what people tell you. It's not enough in the foreseeable future. Some from biomass, a little as we heard from solar, tidal and wave power not yet commercial, nuclear fusion still on the drawing board, wind, well, you heard about wind. It's only intermittent and only 35% efficient. The Institute of Civil Engineering, which presumably knows more about it than any of us, can't see more than 17% of our needs from renewables by 2020. The best hope may be eventually by removing carbon dioxide from fossil fuels and storing it underground. Some 17%, the government tells us, could be reduced in this way. But for 60 to 80%, we need every possible means of reduction, and that includes building nuclear reactors. And that, indeed, incidentally, will enable us to enter the hydrogen economy, which will be essential if we do use less oil. There are today 442 nuclear reactors working safely in the world. 14% of the world's electricity comes from them. 31 nations, as you've heard, representing two-thirds of humanity, has some nuclear energy. The USA has 103 reactors with plans for 50% more. India and China built 9 in the last 4 years and 10 are under construction. In France, 80% comes from nuclear. We buy some of it. I smell a little hypocrisy here. We mustn't build nuclear reactors, oh no. But no one objects to buying it from the French, because we haven't got enough of our own, and no one's scared of going to France because of alleged radiation. The world is using more and more nuclear energy, and poor old Britain, which pioneered it, is getting left behind. What are the objections? Well, cost I leave to my colleague, which I actually don't think is an objection. What about safety? We're told it's not safe. Well, people never objected to coal because it wasn't safe, and many, many people have died in coal mines. But in this country, not one single life has been shown to be lost through nuclear energy. People always bring up Chernobyl. Well, yes, Chernobyl was a terrible accident, but it was an old-fashioned, outdated type of reactor. Every rule in the book was broken in an experiment which should never have taken place. And the proportion of cancer among those in the cleanup operations who've since died is no higher than the proportion in the population as a whole. The media prophesied 40,000 would die. The actual number is 45. Modern reactors are quite different from Chernobyl. Incidentally, they last longer. There is even a reactor being developed in South Africa in which the core automatically shuts down when anything goes wrong. There are today necessary checks, reports, and inspections. And the amount of radiation of those who work in the nuclear industry is less than the natural radiation from the granite rocks of Cornwall. What would happen, people ask, if a plane were forced by terrorists to fly into a reactor? Experiments show that the plane would be vaporized and the containment buildings would suffer only superficial damage. That's all. There are those who say that nuclear reactors would aid proliferation for nuclear weapons. Well, with 442 already, they wouldn't make much difference. In any case, nuclear fuel cannot be used as such in nuclear bombs. The uranium has to be enriched. That's where the danger lies. Then there is waste. Intermediate and high-level waste remains toxic for 5,000 years and over, as we heard. There's not much of it. But is it safe to bury it for so long? Well, Finland, Sweden, and the United States say yes, it is safe. They've already agreed plans. Narex, our body, charged with disposal, also have plans which I've seen. High-level waste will be immobilized in cement grout, in steel drums, placed in a vault with cement backfill material at a depth of 2,000 feet in stable rock formation. There would be a funicular to take the stuff down into a huge vault, 300 meters long, with a ventilation shaft and means of inspection and retrieval, if necessary, during storage. The vault would take 1,500 drums. It would be safe enough there for as long as you like. Now, what the conviction I want to leave you with is that the danger from global warming is far, far worse than any from nuclear energy. It is reliable, safe, cheap, efficient. Refuse it, refuse to build more, and you put posterity in danger. For God's sake, and actually I mean that, for God's sake, vote for posterity.
Bishop, thank you very much indeed. I think next time we switch on a light, actually, we'll remember that the electricity comes from nuclear power stations in France, which is a lovely thought that you've given us. Now, against the motion, speaking next, we have Zach Goldsmith, who has been editor of The Ecologist magazine for 7 years. During that time, he's transformed the publication from an academic journal into a current affairs magazine. It is now published in 6 languages and has influenced environmental and political agendas right across the world since it was launched in 1970. Zach focuses on raising funds for groups around the world dealing with issues ranging from agriculture and energy to climate change and trade. He helped to establish 2 foundations that derive funds from his own family and 2 other foundations that raise funds from elsewhere with a view to distributing them to cutting-edge campaign organizations. In 2003, he was the recipient of the Beacon Prize for Philanthropy, and last year he received the Global Green Award for International Environmental Leadership. He is, I think understandably, going to speak against the motion. Zach.
Thank you very much. When the head of the French nuclear industry was asked about a week before September the 11th whether or not his plants were vulnerable to attacks from the air, he gave a very odd response. "Of course not," he said. "It's illegal to fly planes over nuclear power plants." Well, phew, I suppose you're meant to say. Since then, the industry has had to revise its opinion. So the International Atomic Energy Agency, for example, now admits that a terrorist attack, quote, is far more likely following September the 11th. Its director general went on to say that radiation knows no frontiers. If the terrorist is willing to die, that changes the security equation dramatically. His words, not mine. British Nuclear Fuels, meanwhile, has described the prospect of a commercial jet colliding with a nuclear power plant as unthinkable. Well, they better start thinking about it. Consider this. Sizewell B, which has already been mentioned, in East Anglia, stores its own fuel. It has about 300 tons of volatile fuel in a relatively unguarded pond, relatively in comparison with other parts of the plant. If the power supply was deliberately isolated from the plant, if the emergency generators were crippled, the water that keeps that fuel cool and relatively stable would evaporate, and the fuel would explode, with horrific consequences. Now, for me, it's not comforting to think that we're never more than a few hours away from a nuclear explosion. And contrary to what we've just been told, the nuclear industry is not prepared for this, and I'll explain why. When the Nuclear Installations Inspectorate set out its guidelines all those years ago for new nuclear power plants, it based its risk models on the probability of a small missile, i.e. an aeroplane, hitting a small target, the nuclear power plant, in a geographically vast space, by accident. Not surprisingly, it put the odds at 10 million to 1. In other words, nothing to take into account, nothing to worry about. The truth is, nuclear power plants were never built with terrorism in mind. It's not possible to eradicate that risk. It's possible, maybe, at phenomenal expense to reduce that risk, but I'm not holding my breath, because even peacetime nuclear history is littered with accidents. Chernobyl, Windscale, Three Mile Island, Kishtim, which is one of the most serious. The industry will always insist that a major accident is unlikely. You'd expect it to. But I personally don't go in for public assurances of safety. Don't forget NASA put the odds of the space shuttle Challenger crashing at 100,000 to 1. Well, we know what happened there. Now, I haven't done the maths myself, as you wouldn't expect me to have done. But the insurance industry has. And based on its own risk assessment, it's taken the view that it will only ever cover nuclear power plants on the condition that the government, i.e. the taxpayer, caps the liabilities of the nuclear plant itself. As far as I know, that's a unique arrangement, and it doesn't fill me with much confidence. But let's say that these issues could somehow be magically resolved. I don't believe they can be. Don't forget, when the first nuclear critics complained that or predicted that nuclear industry would create mountains of very dangerous waste that could never be dealt with, they were laughed at. Well, as it happens, what they said was correct. Michael Meacher, the former environment minister, said recently, just before he lost his job, in fact, he was also, by the way, the minister in charge of handling nuclear waste. He described the nuclear waste problem as a problem for which there is no solution. But let's assume these problems can be resolved somehow. we're still left with a fundamentally messy industry. The French reprocessing plant at La Hague, for example, dumps 230 million litres of waste into the Channel every year. If you're a child living near Sellafield, you're 11 times more likely to get leukemia than if you're living elsewhere. This is an accepted fact by the industry. If you're a child living in the town of Šilima, I apologize for my pronunciation, in Estonia, where they've been mining uranium for 50 years, you have a 3 in 10 chance of suffering from what's described as severe nerve damage, among all kinds of other things as well. And no matter where you live, the fact that there were 132 confirmed cases of nuclear theft between 93 and 96, 3 years, has got to be pretty worrying. Given all these horrors, you'd be forgiven, in my view, for assuming that nuclear power must be some kind of energy panacea. Why else would we accept all these risks and dangers? Well, it's not, and we've already heard part of the story. A few months ago, Dick Cheney, Vice President of the United States, complained bitterly that not one single application for a new nuclear power plant has been approved in the States for 20 years. What he didn't say is that not one single application for a new nuclear power plant has been submitted for 20 years in the United States. And there's a very good reason for that. See, it's not health concerns or scientific concerns or security concerns or ideological concerns that have crippled the industry. The market has, and much, much more vehemently than Greens or scientists have ever done. Nuclear power is by far the most expensive form of energy ever invented. We wouldn't be having this debate were it not for the fact that countless politicians have made extravagantly bad decisions with our money. Between 1974 and 1998, OECD governments poured $160 billion of our money, by the way, into nuclear research. Research, not capital cost, research. And you've got the issue of waste, which has been played down, but which is very serious. British Nuclear Fuels has admitted it faces a clean-up bill now of £34 billion. And that figure, it later emerged, is out by a further £13 billion. Even if we don't build any more plants, waste will increase over the next 10 years by at least 500%. Now, no one's ever been able to put a price on the security costs which have arisen largely as a result of 9/11. So we're not even getting cheap energy for all these risks and costs. When it was launched all those years ago, the industry declared that nuclear energy would be clean, safe, and too cheap to meter. That was the phrase that was bandied about. Well, if that's the case, my bookie's a monk. The only justification for continuing with nuclear power is if there are no alternatives. If that were the case, we'd have to accept the cancer clusters, we'd have to accept the cost, we'd have to accept the risks, and so on. But despite virtually no investment, there are proven alternatives. They're a hell of a lot cheaper, they carry zero security risk, and they're clean. Imagine what tidal power, solar power, wind power, energy-saving devices and so on would look like if they'd been given just 1% of the money that's gone into nuclear research. It would be a very different story today. Tony Juniper is going to be making this case very shortly, but I want to repeat what Mr. Blair's own Sustainable Energy Commission told him a few months ago. Quote, "The building of new nuclear stations will only be seen to be necessary if the government fails to realize the potential of energy efficiency and renewables." Nuclear power comes with huge financial, health, environmental, and national security costs. My argument is very simple. Clean, cheap, proven alternatives exist. Why would anyone accept these costs when we know that we don't have to? I urge you to oppose this motion. Thank you.
Well, Zach, thank you very much indeed. And we are all certainly being bombarded with some magnificent facts on both sides this evening. So lots of meet there to help you all make up your minds at the end of the debate. Now, our next speaker, final speaker for the motion, is Lord Parkinson, who has had a distinguished career in politics. He has been Secretary of State for Transport. He's, more particularly from our point of view, has been Secretary of State for Energy from 1987 to 1989. He was also Secretary of State for Trade and Industry. And he was a member of the Falklands War Cabinet. Many of you will remember him at the side of Margaret Thatcher at the 83 election victory. He has since spent a lot of time, not only in the House of Lords, but with a diverse number of companies of which he is director and or chairman. His biography, which he wrote in 1992, was called Right at the Center. So let's see where precisely he stands on this issue. Lord Parton.
Before I start on my own remarks, may I just comment on one or two of my opponent's statements so far. Mr. Schneider is an advisor to the French government. The French government either doesn't listen to him or refuses to take his advice because France is producing a huge proportion of its energy from nuclear power. And he also advises Germany, where a poll has just been held, which for the first time a majority of the German people have said that the plans to phase out nuclear are unrealistic, and a former cabinet minister in Mr. Schroeder's government has predicted that Germany will build new nuclear stations and that Germany will depend on coal and nuclear for its future electricity needs. There has been a decline in nuclear, and part of that is a tribute to the most misleading campaign that environmentalists have made against nuclear. And if you look at the time frame, and Mr. Schneider was saying how long these things take, I think he exaggerated the length of time it will take to build a new station. But if you draw the conclusion that he's right, it is going to take time, my immediate reaction was we have very little time to waste. We should get on with it. And I was a bit disappointed, I have to admit, to hear Zach Goldsmith tot out those old, hoary, totally misleading statements about wind scale. Could I just remind you, Zach, wind scale was not a power station. It was a plutonium factory. And there was an accident there. There has been no major accident in a British nuclear power station in the last 50 years. Not a single person has died in a British nuclear power station. Just as a matter of interest, during that time, the average number of miners who died each year in the coal industry was 45, if you average them over the period. So, 3 Mile Island, nobody was hurt. The containment worked. And Chernobyl, as Hugh Montefiore said, in spite of the huge figures that are bandied about, 700 United Nations scientists have come up with an authoritative figure, 45 people died, and up to 2,000 people may have developed cancer of the thyroid, some of them as a result of the new Chernobyl accident. So when the environmentalists trot out this trio of scare stories, one has to examine them and see the truth of the matter. I am a former energy secretary, as Martin said, and when I went into the Department of Energy, I went in with an absolutely open mind. My reaction was, I wasn't a devotee of any particular source of energy, and my immediate only sole concern was to keep the lights on, to keep the country moving, working, and warm. And that was, I realized that fossil fuels are finite. We have to use them in the most sparing way we can. And therefore, those were the two things that drove my thinking in that department. And to that end, I ruled out nothing. I actually had an energy efficiency audit of my own house. How many people here have had energy efficiency audit of their homes? Congratulations, you're part of a very small, well-informed minority. But the fact of the matter is that we saw the importance, and this was 87, of energy efficiency. And the government has expended huge amounts of money in promoting energy efficiency. One of the problems is that energy consumption goes up and up. And if people save less on heating their houses, now with IT and the internet and the information technology age we live in, consumption is actually rising because people are using it for more reasons, energy, than they did before. I expanded the budget and the activities of the Energy Efficiency Office, and everybody following me in that department has done the same. But I became very concerned that security of supply, which is all important, to have a secure access to electricity, depended on diversity of sources of supply. We have coal, gas, nuclear, renewables, energy efficiency, anything that we could do to diversify and reduce our needs, I was all in favor of. And the biggest boost, by the way, to renewables was given in the Electricity Act of 1989, which set aside a quota which could be supplied and must be supplied by renewable producers of renewable energy. They had a right to sell the electricity they produced at a price that would ensure they had a profit. And that was the first time any government had actually given a tax and fiscal incentive for people to go into the production of renewable energy. So I had no preference for nuclear. I just had a realization that we, in spite of all our efforts on energy efficiency, there was an expanding demand, and to meet it, we had to have a diversity of supply. In those days, we had a problem because 80% of all the prime fuels of our electricity industry came from one company, British Coal. So a nationalized electricity producer supplied by a nationalized prime fuel supplier for 80% of his prime fuels was the situation that we found. Of course, what happened was that people like Arthur Scargill suddenly spotted the opportunity to turn economic power into political power. And the miners did get rid of one government and tried to get rid of another. And so I became more than ever convinced we needed diversity. Without the nuclear power stations during that strike, the lights would have gone out and British industry would have been crippled. Imagine we're now moving, if our environmentalist friends have their way, into a situation where we're going to be 80% dependent again, 80% dependent on imported gas. So we couldn't control the interference of a nationalized industry supplying another one. We're now going to put our future, if they have their way, in the hands of Algeria, Russia, and the Middle East. We're going to put our whole economic future and our well-being in the hands of a group of people who have no real commitment to us at a price we don't know, because as demand rises, the price will rocket. And so we're having learned a lesson of the danger, I hope having learned a lesson, of the danger of being over-dependent on one source. We're now planning to be over-dependent on another, which is totally outside our control. And Zach recited all these amazing things, which at no cost and with no problems about supply are available at our disposal. The simple truth of the matter is they are light years away from being available. Wind power is good, and we want as much of it as we can get. We have to recognize if the wind doesn't blow, you don't get it. So you have to have standby conventional power stations available to make up for any shortfall. And that reduces some of the energy carbon dioxide saving that you actually get from the renewable source. If you have to have conventional power available on demand, if wind isn't working, then the effects, the beneficial effects for the environment are that much reduced. In my opinion, nuclear, for a number of reasons, some of which have been touched on, is an answer. It's not the answer, Of course, if we can develop renewables, let's do it. Energy efficiency, yes. Anything we can do to reduce our dependence on gas. But at the end of the day, we need baseload suppliers of power. Suppliers of baseload power. And the only one, other than fossil fuels, which is on the horizon, the only baseload producer is, in fact, nuclear. I won't talk about the reasons. Hugh touched on a number of them, but I mentioned no deaths, the Three Mile Island. Waste is perfectly manageable. The only problem is that somebody has to take a decision. That Finland's taken it, Sweden's taken it, the US is taking it. There is no problem that just requires willpower. And at the moment, I'm afraid that British politicians seem to lack it. Hugh mentioned natural radiation in Cornwall. I remember my first day in the Department of Energy, our press officer said to me, if Cornwall was a nuclear power station, we'd have to close it down. It just was a very graphic way of describing the level of natural radiation that exists in almost all parts of the country. The cost, you can choose between Zach Goldsmith or the Royal Academy of Engineering, which did an absolutely independent study of all the sources of energy and their respective costs. Gas and nuclear, 2.2 to 2.3 pence per kilowatt hour. Wind, 3.9, but 5.4. If you take into account the conventional power stations you have to have available. I think I'm much more likely to believe the Royal Academy of Engineering than I am Zach, much as though I like him and I admire the speech that he gave us.
Cecil, thank you very much indeed for that. And our final speaker against the motion is Tony Juniper, who has been an environmental campaigner for nearly 20 years. Since 2003, he's been the executive director of Friends of the Earth in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. And for 3 years before that, he was the vice chair of Friends of the Earth International, which is the global federation of 68 national Friends of the Earth organizations. He's played a prominent role in many of the Friends of the Earth's most prominent campaigns. He helped change the policy of the World Bank, harnessed consumer pressure to promote sustainable forestry. He was a leading figure in the campaign against road building that led to dramatic shifts in national transport policy, and he's prominent in efforts that led to the agreement of the Kyoto Protocol in 1997. Now, he's worked not only to shift public opinion and government policy, but has been very successful in changing the policies and practices of many international companies, such as Rio Tinto, BP, Shell, and Balfour Beatty. He is now active in the Friends of the Earth campaign to change UK and international law so as to promote more sustainable companies. Tony Juniper.
Thank you very much.
Good evening. Cut to the chase. The implication of this evening's motion is that we have no choice in going forward with a large-scale expansion of nuclear power. No choice in relation to securing energy for our country for the future, in terms of diminishing supply of fossil fuels like gas, for example, and no choice in terms of meeting the growing and awesome threat of global warming. I will address my comments to both of these assumptions, particularly picking up some of the points that have been made by other speakers on the threat of climate change in particular. But I want to start by making a really fundamental point that nobody else has made, and that is that there is a great distinction between climate change policy and energy policy. The reality is that in this country right now, we get about 29% of our carbon dioxide emissions come from electricity generation. Carbon dioxide is in turn responsible for about 85% of our greenhouse gas emissions. This means, in turn, that changes to our policy in terms of nuclear, even if we did all that we could only affect about a quarter of the emissions coming from this country by going down the nuclear route and going through that route to generate electricity. 75% of the emissions in this country are coming directly from industry, coming from the transport sector, from agriculture, and from greenhouse gases that have got nothing to do with energy at all. Methane, for example, in farming and in agriculture. The challenge is huge. We do need to address the electricity sector, but that will only deal with a quarter of the problem. Let's put this in perspective. Certainly, we need to discuss how we're going to deal with a quarter of that problem, and I will come to that in a second. But the crucial point to begin this part of the discussion is about the scope of nuclear power. Fortunately, we don't have nuclear-powered aeroplanes. We don't yet have nuclear-powered cars. And nuclear power isn't going to stop emissions coming from farming. Certainly, we have to do something about electricity. And nuclear certainly has to be part of the debate. But as I will say this evening, we believe that there is no need to do it. There are alternatives to the drawbacks of nuclear power. The vast challenges posed by the long-term management of radioactive waste. Certainly, we've had radioactive waste being generated for 50 years. We've got to look after it for about a quarter of a million years. What kind of a legacy is that to bequeath to our children? It's expensive. Nuclear power has had a long track record of cost overruns and continues to be a draw on public money worldwide. Nuclear power programs worldwide have also been the source of nuclear weapons programs. Right now, a debate is going on about what to do about North Korea and Iran. Both countries that have adopted civilian nuclear programs and have the technology, so it is said, to enrich materials to make weapons-grade uranium for bombs. All those things are very serious problems that have been joined more recently by the threat of terrorism. What you've heard this evening from those speaking for the motion, I think, gives the impression that it's simply a question of giving some planning consents, and then at some point in the near future, someone will flick a switch and nuclear power will suddenly come back to power our houses and our industries. I think in the real world, the real political world that we live in, given that there's new reactors that have to be licensed, a whole new political discussion has to happen about the role of nuclear power in a carbon-challenged world, it seems quite plausible that it would take 20 years before we had even one light bulb powered by a nuclear station, a new nuclear station, in this country. And 20 years, quite simply put, is far too long. The government's Climate Change Task Force reported in February that emissions have to come down now. We don't have the luxury of 2 decades to have a debate about nuclear power or not. And given what Michael has told us about the long-term decline of nuclear that's happening, real data shows that, we have to find a way of filling the gap, recognising that we don't have the luxury of time and that we need to take action now. For our part of the work that we've done at Friends of the Earth, we believe that the answers lie in energy efficiency, the cleaner use of fossil fuels, and the large-scale development of renewable power. Nuclear stations in this country provide, as has been said earlier, about 1/5 of our electricity. Even if we doubled that capacity by some magic technological fix that we could come forward with tomorrow, tomorrow we would only reduce this country's emissions by 8%. That is not a very significant level of emissions reductions given what the previous speakers have said about the need for 80% reductions by mid-century, and certainly that is the scale of what is needed. We have to find a way of filling the gap. A diverse range of technologies is what is needed, rather than going down the nuclear route that won't deliver in time, even if it was technically and financially feasible. Wind power is already delivering in this country more and more of our energy needs. And if you look at the Energy Trends survey published by the Department for Trade and Industry that came out looking at the 2004 figures for energy generation in this country, you will find that nuclear power, despite what some of its proponents say in terms of its reliability, went up and down by about 10% in terms of its contribution between the quarterly reports of 2004, and overall dropped in terms of its contribution to grid power in this country by 10% over that same year. At the same time, renewable energy sources contributed an increasing level of power to our national needs of 7%, 7% increase in the contribution by proportion of renewable energy. In summary, we're seeing at the moment, in real data being published by the Department of Trade and Industry, a decline in the contribution of nuclear and an increase in the contribution of renewables, and as far as I can see, the lights haven't yet gone out. There have been discussions about the possibilities for increasing renewable energies and whether it's technically feasible. Well, it's happening. There are wind farms now producing power in this country that are providing energy to the national grid and including to consumers who want to favour that particular energy source by going to energy suppliers who provide only green energy. There's a market there. That market is already leading to an increase in wind power. Certainly there's a discussion to be had about the siting of wind turbines, but the growth in wind power in the coming years has an enormous potential to increase from the 2 or 3% it provides now to getting on for 20% without posing technical challenges for the grid in terms of intermittency of supply that could occur as wind speeds change. 5 megawatt wind turbines are now being trialled in Germany, and those will be brought to market soon. The prospects of 200 of those turbines working together in offshore installations, providing the equivalent energy to a nuclear power station, that is now a near-term prospect, and that is what we should be going for. Energy efficiency has massive potential. If this country had a program of adopting micro CHP boilers in 15 million houses, that would be an equivalent saving of energy to 15 nuclear power stations. These kinds of technological solutions, those step changes in energy efficiency, are available now. And if you don't believe what's possible in the future, look at what's happening right now. The borough of Woking in Surrey in 1990 adopted a climate change policy. That led to the installation of the first fuel cell generator in this country in Woking, a wide range of energy efficiency measures, district CHP being used not only by the council, but also to provide electricity for buildings, hotels, nightclubs, amenities, and other users in the near vicinity. That's now been supplemented with solar PV, leading to, listen to this figure, a 77% reduction in carbon dioxide emissions arising from the borough's use of energy. That's not in the future, that's happening now. Even closer to our venue this evening, the Bedsted development in South London is the first large-scale carbon-neutral community in the UK using no more energy than it produces. Its principal energy source is tree trimmings coming from the cutting of urban trees being used in CHP, very efficient and effective use of that energy to provide power and the heating needs for a whole community with zero net carbon dioxide emissions. And it's also the case that fossil fuels aren't necessarily doomed to a total phase-out. An exciting research agenda is now developing in the field of carbon sequestration, taking efficient burning of coal, capturing the carbon dioxide, and putting it beneath the ground in former gas wells, for example. That is a very exciting agenda that not only could render fossil fuels more carbon neutral, but would also be the possible source of technology transfer to countries like India and China, who in the future will certainly be using more fossil fuels, and who, as a result of technological developments here, could be using it more cleanly. And finally, if you're still convinced that nuclear power is a solution to climate change, look at the situation of the United States. That country produces more nuclear energy than any other, and yet that country produces more carbon dioxide than any other as well. It's not a solution. Look forward, not backwards. Thank you.
Tony, thank you very much indeed. And it is now time to throw it open to questions and comments from the floor. In a moment, I'm going to read out the result of your voting when you came in. But can I just explain before I do that just how we're going to handle the questions and comments that you might have to make? Can I say that we want to get in as many people as possible? So please, no speeches from the floor, but we would very much welcome some nice, concise comments as well as questions. There are two people here who've got microphones who will be moving on the ground floor. If you have any questions or comments from the gods, from the balcony, would you be... I'm sorry, Bishop, I shouldn't have mentioned that in your presence, but if you have any questions from upstairs, could you please line up at the microphone that is in the middle of the balcony, and I'll take your questions as soon as possible. And now, the result of the vote that you undertook as you came in, there are 600 people here who voted. 258 are for, that is agreeing that nuclear energy must power our future. 155 are against, but interestingly, there are 186 who don't know, who presumably have come to weigh up the arguments and maybe change themselves from a don't know to either for or against when we do our second vote later on. Now, that second vote is unusually, and for those of you who don't know the Intelligence Squared debates, that second vote takes place during the two-minute summing ups that we're going to have from the speakers. That is, I know it's unusual, but by that time you will have heard a lot of the arguments, and you will vote in an interesting way, just so I can prepare you for that. You will be handed out cards. In fact, you've got cards. You will tear them in half, and you'll put either the yes half or the no half into the boxes that come round. If you want to be a don't know, then you put the whole card untorn into the box, and that is the way we do it. So just to prepare you for that, let's now open it up to the floor. Who would like to? I think, yes, the gentleman over there in the spotlight in the blue shirt. And after that, can I take, who over here wanted to? Yes, can I take the gentleman just here after that? But you first, sir. Could you just give us your name and if you've got any particular interest on the part of some organisation, that would be helpful.
My name is Mark Johnston. I work for Friends of the Earth in Brussels. Because we also share the platform, I'll be very brief. My question is particularly to Lord Parkinson. When you were in office as a minister, you and your colleagues in the UK, not only in this country, but led the world in the liberalisation and privatisation of the energy sector, and you touched on that in your speech. Given that that directly led to the bankruptcy of the two principal nuclear operators in this country in 2002 and 2001, do you think that policy trend that you introduced, both in the UK and around the world, was now a mistake and we should go back to state planning? And if you don't, what policy mechanisms do you propose now to close the subsidy gap in order to aid nuclear power? Because without subsidies, no one is building reactors, quite simply.
Well, could I say, first of all, without subsidy, nobody would have erected a single wind generator. Nuclear at that time did need subsidy. It actually doesn't need subsidy anymore. The reason why British Energy, which is the company you're referring to, got into difficulties was because of a very technical change in the pricing mechanism, in the market mechanism, which resulted in prices, which you wouldn't approve of, I'm sure, being depressed, as a result of which nuclear power wasn't competitive. Now that gas prices and other prices have gone up, British Energy is in fact profitable. It was purely a technical change in the pricing arrangements which shoved the prices down, which gave rise to this problem. It's been solved now. The government offered to put in up a loan. It wasn't necessary. British Energy is now profitable. So I'm never going to apologise for privatisation. Although you don't approve of it, it had the effect of reducing prices by more than 30% and giving everybody in the country a choice of up to 30 suppliers of electricity. I happen to think that's a good thing. I'm sure you think it's a bad one.
Can I just ask you whether you do believe that nuclear energy now, with the new power stations, is commercially viable? And if so, can you pick up Zach's point about there being no plan submitted for nuclear plants in the United States for 20 years, presumably on commercial grounds?
Well, the
25 years.
I saw that President Bush the other day made a statement saying it was time that America did turn to nuclear, and he expects the nuclear industry to get a boost. As I say, the environment...
Commercially viable?
Commercially viable. In fact, new nuclear power stations produce 10% of the previous waste, a huge reduction. The technology has been evolved and is now much simpler to build and to license. And it's 10%, only 10% of the waste. And the cost of nuclear, costed by the Royal College of Engineering, is actually one half of wind power on shore and one third of wind power at sea. So, and it is profitable at those price levels.
Michael.
And by the way, included in that price is the cost of decommissioning and processing waste, which no other source of energy makes any provision for.
Michael.
Well, let me say the US nuclear revival comes back every 5 years. I can't recall any any other president who was more pro-nuclear than Mr. Reagan, for example. So what Mr. Bush says now is not so relevant. The question is, where are the orders? The last order in the United States that was carried out, which means that wasn't subsequently canceled, dates from October 1973. The entire fleet of the 103 reactors operating in the United States have been ordered over a 10-year period between 1963 and 1973. And you say we're living in the past?
Right, let's move on and take another question from the gentleman down here. Yes, John. And then can we go to this lady just here? And then I'll take it. If you go to the microphone so you're ready to ask the question, sir, that'd be great.
Yes. John Maddox, ex-editor of Nature. I like the way that Bishop Montefiore put the case for the motion, which I'm going to support. He said, if what they say about global warming is true, then we shall need everything we can get, nuclear power included, as a source of energy. I agree with that. Let me add this mean comment. I'm despondent at the prospect that our funny old world will be able to agree on a workable international regime for doing this. Kyoto's acknowledged to be a first step, a small one. Has to be followed by much bigger steps. There's no prospect that India and China will sign up to dreams like that, as things are. I have other mean comments. One of them is about Mr. Goldsmith's remarks. First time, by the way, I've ever heard the ecologist called a learned journal, once upon a time. He drew attention to the problem of radiation and used this very, very misleading and, in fact, untrue charge that if you live near Windscale, your children are more likely to get leukemia than if you live elsewhere. It's a complicated issue, as has been well rehearsed in the learned journals, and is by no means clear that there's any link with nuclear radiation. But there is a problem with waste. And Mr. Goldsmith also mentioned Mr. Meacher, lately at the Department of the Environment. I think if he had been a man of higher principle, he wouldn't have taken the job because he knew he would have to make some devious choices in his tenure of it. It was he who, having had a report from NIREX, the organization set up to handle radioactive waste in an earlier, the Thatcher government, Meacher really helped along the process by which no decision was taken as a consequence of the reports that NIREX had made, and the idea of burying the waste, first embedded in glass or cement, and then buried in caverns underground, that idea was left hanging in the wind, and Michael Meacher was as pleased as punch that that's the way it came out. The fact is that nuclear waste is handleable. It's been dealt with successfully in Japan, in the United States, Finland, and Sweden, and it can be done again by prescribed methods. So nuclear waste is really a bogey erected by, if I may say so, this is another brief mean remark.
Your final remark is,
I think the role of the environmental organizations in heightening public fear about all these things has been disreputable. Thank you.
Heightening public fear appears to be the role of the environmentalists. Tony, if you want to talk about that in just a second, but Zach, to specifically give you a chance to address the the allegations about your information that you're using in your speech.
Yeah, I mean, the key allegation is that I invented the cancer clusters at Sellafield. Now, I mean, actually, the industry itself doesn't deny that the cancer cluster is there. And in fact, the figure is, I gave you a very conservative figure, 11%, 11 times the national average is the most conservative figure I've ever seen. In fact, it's usually quoted at 16 times the national average. And it's sufficiently accepted by the industry that the industry has commissioned endless scientific studies to try and distance that cluster from the Sellafield power, the radioactive waste emanating from Sellafield. And it's, for me, it's a classic case of PR men posing as scientists being commissioned to take a conclusion and devise all kinds of bogus arguments to justify that conclusion. But the fact is, there is no evidence linking, there's no evidence for any other cause of cancer besides the radioactive waste that Sellafield has, and the cancer cluster is there. There's just no point denying it. I've never met anyone associated with the nuclear industry who does deny it, so this is not my figure. This is absolutely accepted. There are paper after paper after paper has been published by the nuclear industry.
And Tony, this point about about frightening, yes, you know, you're frightening the natives, yes, as it were, unnecessarily.
Indeed. Well, I think all of the work that we've done over the years in drawing attention to the intractable problems posed with nuclear waste storage and disposal, questions of cost, questions of proliferation and countries using nuclear programs to develop weapon programs, and more recently the question of terrorism. I think, you know, this is part of a public debate that is not solely being shaped by Friends of the Earth and Greenpeace. There is a very active nuclear industry, many leading political figures who are joining in on the side of the nuclear companies and the nuclear interests, who are putting the other side of the debate. And my charge back to you would be that they're being irresponsible with their reassurances, both in terms of what can be done and what will be the implications of it. Now, one point you made about Mr. Meacher and his alleged blocking of NIREX's proposals to come forward with disposal options in this country for nuclear waste, actually the most important decision taken in relation to a proposal made by UK NIREX was taken by John Gummer, a Conservative Environment Secretary working for a pro-nuclear government, who quite rightly saw the technical flaws in the NIREX case in relation to the long-term certainty they would have about nuclear waste being stored in the Lake District rock formations in the Borrowdale volcanoes for 250,000 years. Timescales that defy comprehension, but Mr. Gummer rightly saw that there was no case that could be made to guarantee that people in the future, in thousands of generations' time, our children's children's children, thousands of generations' time, would be subject to risk as a result of decisions being taken now. And Mr. Gummer took a very brave, long-term, bold decision. He was a pro-nuclear minister. He has a nuclear power station in his constituency, but he saw the technical flaws and he stood up and did the right thing.
Bishop.
I just want to say that I did take part in a debate in Islington on nuclear energy, and Mr. Gummer spoke on the same side as I was.
Exactly. Indeed, that's exactly my point. My point is exactly that. Mr. Gummer is pro-nuclear, but he didn't believe the safety case that was being made by a very reassuring pitch being made by the nuclear industry. That's exactly it. And good on him for having an honourable approach to taking decisions.
But does this all come back to a point that you made, Cecil, about, I think you said politicians have no willpower. I mean, yes. is the nuclear issue so sensitive that notwithstanding any kind of debate about pressing need, that politicians don't want to have that debate because they simply don't want to take the decision because of all the publicity, if you like, surrounding the nuclear industry over the last 30, 40 years?
First of all, I was a member of a government that did believe in nuclear power and did commission public inquiries about the next two nuclear stations. And so we felt where there was a will, there was a way. What happened subsequently, and certainly this is the case with the waste store, the cost is very substantial. And there is a body in government which is even more powerful than the Department of Energy, which no longer is good, or the Department of Environment. It's called the Treasury. And the Treasury took one look at the cost and ran away. In other countries, they are braver, and they take these decisions. There is no technical problem. There is a cost problem. But built into the cost of nuclear is also the cost of waste disposal. And sooner or later,
somebody in this country will be brave and grasp the nettle, and we will have a deep store, and nuclear waste will be safely stored. There is no problem about it except willpower and money.
But do you think the decision would have to take place in the first year of a new government, because otherwise it gets too close to the
election?
Well,
I actually think it's rather interesting that the mood in this country is undoubtedly changing. I will be very, very surprised if the Labour government doesn't announce something about nuclear power. I've no way of knowing, by the way, but all the signs are the government softening its tone. That they're beginning to realise that if they need baseload power in the future, this country does, then it's going to have to get it from nuclear.
So you think Labour will win the next election?
I don't know. they might. I'm above that sort of thing now. I don't even talk.
Tony, very quickly.
Well,
Tony,
can I ask Lord Parkinson if?
Hang on, I don't want you asking a question. Just make a quick comment, and then we'll go to the lady up there.
Well, I believe his belief in leadership more if we heard him proposing a deep level waste dump in his constituency in the run up to this election.
I would have thought that Hertfordshire is about as unsuitable a place as you That's could find. But I don't, by the way, just for the record, I don't have a constituency anymore. I haven't had since 1992.
Well, your successor. Perhaps you persuade him or her.
Look forward, not backwards.
Right, so he's asking you.
But your constituency.
Right. He's asking you to get your facts right on that one, I think. Right, the lady, the gentleman up at the top.
He's turned into a gentleman. Chris Elliott, I'm an engineer and a lawyer. If you ask us to declare any interests, I have only one, that one of my clients is Woking Borough Council on the sustainability programme. So I'm apparently on that side of the room. I'm worried about the asymmetry of integrity, if you like, in statements. Most of the pro-nuclear lobbying comes from public authorities. It comes from state companies, ministers, public bodies. They're subject to scrutiny. Everything they say is minuted, is challengeable, maybe challenged in Parliament. They have to be very careful about every statement they make. It'll come back to haunt them. The great value of the environmental movement is it's not constrained by that. They are free to raise concerns, to alert us to problems otherwise we'd just stay below the radar horizon for politics. But that brings with it a very large responsibility. And my question, my challenge, if you like, is, do you use that responsibility? What, do you live up to that responsibility? I'll give you one example from this evening where I think you do not. I'm trying to narrow down John Mannix's point, really. Something else that Mr. Goldsmith said, if I can read my notes in this light, speaking of a plant where we are a few hours from a nuclear explosion. Now, I think what you meant was not a nuclear explosion in the sense that everybody reads that term to mean a fission reaction, a Hiroshima. What you meant was a conventional explosion that will distribute radioactive material. Now, that is a lot less frightening, but the words you chose to use are terrifying. And my concern is that you are using the liberty you have to alert us to dangers irresponsibly.
Zach, use of language.
Use of language. Look, if nuclear fuel catches fire, blows up, that's a very, very serious, very, very serious incident. In fact, I mean, that Kyushtin was probably in the Urals, which probably most people here don't know about, despite the fact that it caused a 200 by 100 square kilometer radioactive wasteland in which all inhabitants were evacuated. This is something most people don't know about because the UK Atomic Energy Authority took the view, which is now, by the way, in the records, this is not something, my opinion, this is fact, took the view that this was not something that was worth bringing up because it might jeopardize plans in relation to Sellafield and so on. But in terms of environmentalists using scare tactics and so on, I mean, I've been very careful, I think, in using examples which come from people not associated with the environmental movement. Now, the insurance industry, which is known as the risk industry, it's the only big industrial sector which must, as well as it possibly can, predict the future and assess the risk in association with whatever it is it's looking at. The nuclear industry will not touch nuclear power, which is why when you talk about the future of nuclear power in the United States, what you're not mentioning is that, again, the American nuclear industry also will not touch the, the American insurance industry will not touch nuclear power. Dick Cheney has had to offer all kinds of carrots, one of which is that the government will step in and take the place of a nervous insurance industry, i.e. the taxpayer will take it on.
Zach, let's get back to this terminology thing. I mean, do you think that it is part of your brief, or should be part of your brief, to draw a distinction between the phrase nuclear explosion, which means to a lot of people a mushroom cloud, and as the questioner just said, a conventional explosion which distributes radioactivity?
For me, it's not a great big step between the two. I mean, obviously, when you're talking about a nuclear... When you're talking about a nuclear power plant, you're obviously not talking about a mushroom cloud. When you're talking about nuclear waste, which is what I was talking about, or fuel, you're not talking about a mushroom cloud. You're talking about an explosion which dissipates and spreads a lot of very small radioactive particles which can go far and wide, which can affect... I mean, you know, look at the statistics of infant mortality in Bavaria following Chernobyl. Startling. I mean, the figures are actually clear, Chernobyl had a very big impact. There's no doubt about it. And if you read even President Gorbachev's memoirs written long after the incident, he was obviously the boss at the time in the Soviet Union, he admits that the figures were fiddled mercilessly. That's the term he uses. Anyone here can check that out in his memoirs. So I'm very skeptical of the figures that have emerged or that have been bandied about in relation to Chernobyl. But I mean, that's, you know, so for me, to go back to the original question, it's not a great big leap.
Yeah. Let me just move on and take, maybe if I can, just two very quick questions before we move. You have the microphone already. I have no choice. I have to.
Irene Beda, just a member of the public. I just wanted to ask Tony Juniper about wind power. And of people of the panel, could they explain what percentage of the countryside must be covered with windmills before it becomes efficient? And as executive director of Friends of the Earth, how do you feel about the visual pollution?
Okay. Yeah. Yes. So, how much wind power do we have before it becomes?
How many windmills covering the country before we?
Okay. Well, to get to about 20% of our electricity generation from wind turbines in this country, assuming all of it was onshore, and I don't think anybody's saying it all should be onshore, including the access roads and the footings for the turbines, you take up about 8 square kilometres of the country. And the country as a whole is 250,000 square kilometres, more or less. So it's a very, very tiny percentage of total land take that would be needed in order to generate that level.
But isn't the point where they are, how they're distributed?
Well, she just asked me the percentage of land, so that's that bit. Yes, then, of course, you have to find places where the wind is blowing sufficiently strongly, sufficiently reliably during the course of the year to be able to generate power. That then brings up often upland sites, coastal sites, and then that's when we get into the discussion about the visual impact. And this is obviously a very controversial subject right now, not least because we're entering into a big planning inquiry.
Is it worth the visual impact?
Well, I take the view that, yes, it is worth the visual impact, because we have to take some difficult choices in meeting our energy needs as we go forward. And whatever we decide, it's going to have an impact. There is no such thing as free energy in terms of how we can provide for a modern industrialised country, meeting people's needs for leisure, transport and everything else. There are impacts, whether it's radioactive waste, carbon dioxide emissions, or wind turbines on the horizon, there are impacts. My personal view is that I like wind turbines. I like the way they look, they give me hope, they inspire me, and I think they add to the countryside.
Henry, final question from the gentleman up there. Yes, sir.
I worked for BNFL as a director for several years. I have never met, with reference to Zach's suggestion about clusters, any member of the nuclear industry who accepted his proposition. The cluster isn't actually, the cluster such as it is, was not round Sellafield anyway. It was round one of the villages nearby where some nuclear workers worked. It was not round other villages where they also worked. It's a complete myth.
Right. Thank you. And at that point, all right, let me take one more. One more very quickly. Yes, the lady just there. Very quick point. Promise me? Okay.
Thanks. I'm Jennifer Nady.
Yeah, and then actually I will take one more from up on top. Just one more.
Okay? A member of the...
Because I haven't been terribly fair to the folks up on top. Okay.
Thanks. It seems to me really simple. We're talking about how to save the planet, and those for the motion are choosing an answer which could potentially jeopardise the planet all over again. We've heard from Mr. Combi that it would take a minimum of 8 years. That's assuming we could get planning permission for new nuclear power stations to come online. And from Mr. Juniper, that would only solve the problem of 30% of our emissions. I'd like to ask Mr. Juniper, in that time that it would take to bring new nuclear power stations online, what could you do and how much could you reduce emissions by?
Well, may I?
Yes, absolutely.
The opportunity is absolutely vast, and that's why I mentioned those two examples this evening, Woking and Bedsted, where there's working examples of a combination of energy efficiency and renewables bringing down emissions drastically by very considerable margins, the order of magnitude that we need going forward. Now, the point made earlier by John Maddox, which I agree with, is that we have to take drastic steps now to bring down carbon dioxide emissions, but there are real choices here. There isn't an infinite amount of money and wealth to go round in developing the way forward. If we get on the nuclear route, literally billions of pounds will be diverted away from energy efficiency and renewables. And there's some research published only last month in the United States Energy Review that confirms figures that we've seen before by other researchers that hold that $1 spent on energy efficiency will give you 7 times the emissions reduction than $1 spent on nuclear power. That's the route we have to go down for cost reasons, apart from anything else. But the opportunity is vast. I mentioned some of the figures earlier about micro-CHP. 3 energy-efficient light bulbs being placed into every single house in this country would reduce emissions by 1.5 million tonnes of carbon dioxide. That's one power station, out of commission, no difference noticed by the public.
Bruno.
I would like to answer your question and Tony Juniper's. In fact, we do have an example of a country who has gone this way. It's Denmark. Denmark has been constructing a large number of windmills since many decades. And when we look at what a Danish citizen puts into the atmosphere today, well, we can see that Danish citizen emits carbon dioxide into the atmosphere per inhabitant 50% more than a Frenchman. So I am thinking that the example we should follow is more the example of France than the example of Denmark. Because once you have wasted large amounts of money into building hundreds of windmills which produce almost nothing in the global production of consumption of a country, then what do you do for the other 95%? Well, you do polluting coal energy, and that's a big step backwards. So I think we should look frontward, not backwards. Also, I would like to underline the fact that wind energy is not a recent energy. It's already more than 150 years old. And it's still producing not very much, although huge amounts of public money in various countries have been put as subsidies to help it develop. But it's still not out of the bush, still not working well, still intermittent, and unfortunately the wind does not always blow. Nuclear energy is rather much more recent. It appeared only about 50 years ago, and it is already producing 7% of the world's energy today and about 15% of the electricity. And this could be increased very much. So to answer this young lady's question about what we can do, well, it's very simple. We have an example on the planet. It's called France. It's not because it's my country. But in 1973, when the first oil shock came, this decision was taken in a very short amount of time to build a nuclear program. So we have the feedback now. We know how much time it takes. The last nuclear reactor in France of this program was put online in December 1999. It took exactly 26 years to go from almost nothing in the electricity production to 80% of the electricity production. And given the great urgency of the situation today, both because of the oil dependence we have and the situation in the Middle East, and because of global change, global climate change, it is urgent that we now act, and not just act on dreams like some of the other speakers have proposed. We need solutions that work today because it is urgent. And the
Bruno.
Time span that is necessary to implement those solutions is 25 years, so it is urgent to act very fast.
Save it for your summing up, because okay. I felt we were getting your 2 minutes summing up there, actually, just for a brief moment. Can I take one final point from the lady up there? Yeah.
It feels as if this debate is happening about 20 or 30 years too late.
Yeah.
And I'm amazed that this conversation this evening has not got moved forward really at all, despite the fact that there are no new plans for nuclear power stations in the USA and there aren't any applications been put in for 20 years or more, that we're still going around in circles. I want to ask the panel one question. Do they think that there is a generational problem here? Are there a group of people that were young adults post-Second World War that are fixated on the quick fix idea of cheap energy through the nuclear age? Haven't they learned that it's not a quick fix, that it is so complicated? How can we place our faith in an energy source that interferes with a natural cycle of nature, which has a much longer inheritance than the other types of energy that have, the newer renewable sorts of energy which have been mentioned this evening? Is there a problem with the way in which we weight certain pieces of information that we hear tonight? Is that weighting strongly biased by the short-term economic effect of decisions that we make based on our capitalist, consumerist society?
Well, I think that is an interesting thought for us to carry into the voting, which we are now going to do. So if you could start collecting the votes. You know what to do. Just drop the half that says either tear it in half, drop the half that says yes or no into the box, depending on whether you want to vote for the motion or against it. The motion is to remind you that nuclear energy must power our future. Yes, if you're in favour of that. No, if you're against. If you wish to remain a don't know, then just drop the whole ballot sheet in there. And while we are doing that, ladies and gentlemen, as is our tradition, I'm going to ask our speakers to deliver, if you like, a final 1.5 to 2 minute peroration in reverse order to that in which they made their original speeches. So, Tony, could I ask you first a quick minute and a half to 2 minutes?
Yes, I think the burden of this evening's debate in terms of why we need to embrace nuclear power in terms of the arguments put by the other side and conversely by us against the motion, it's been focused on the subject of climate change. And I think everybody has agreed that climate change is real, it's happening now, it's extremely serious, and emergency action is needed to deal with it. From our side, I think the overwhelming point that we would like to make is that nuclear power, not only should it not deliver, it can't deliver. Nuclear power is in decline worldwide. There isn't capacity in nuclear programs across the globe to meet that huge gap between emissions reductions and power supply changes that are needed to do that. Not only that, even if nuclear power could be massively expanded, it will only deal with a quarter of the problem. The vast majority of greenhouse gas emissions are outside the electricity generating sector and therefore cannot be dealt with by nuclear power. So if you can't deal a blow against climate change with nuclear power, the argument in favour of a massive expansion of nuclear power programmes, the argument evaporates. Fortunately, this isn't simply about one technology. This is about a whole range of options that the world still has in the 20 or so years that remain. We can embrace an energy revolution. This is not about technology, it's about culture and whether our society is willing to face up to its global environmental responsibilities by a combination of switching to a diverse range of renewables, cleaning up fossil fuels that remain, and there's a great deal of scope for that, and of course embarking on programs of energy efficiency which can deliver step changes in emissions without anybody noticing a difference to their quality of life. Hybrid vehicles, energy efficient light bulbs, micro CHP and the rest of it. Those technologies exist now. If we move forward quickly with investment, incentives, public awareness programs, there is still time to avoid the worst consequences of climate change. But if we embrace the nuclear route, we will lose the opportunity because the money that's available will be wasted and so will the time that's available.
Tony. Lord Parkinson.
Could I just answer the young lady who spoke last? Yes, there is a generational point. And the generational point is this, that your generation will be the generation that suffers if Tony Jupiter and co. are wrong. You will be the ones who will be cold. You'll be the ones who won't have the electricity you need. So don't think that it's... Hugh and I, I'm sorry to have to say, are not likely to suffer. If you... But you could. So there is a generational point. Could I just make a few brief points? Tony talks about wind power. The last figure I saw for wind power is providing 0.5, one half of 1%. And a 7% increase in wind power therefore adds 0.035. So we are now producing 0.535 of our electricity from wind power. And somehow, at no cost and without pain, we're going to expand that to 20%, just like that, as somebody once said. Could I talk again about the scale of the problem? Britain has 55,000 megawatts of capacity. A station producing 1,000 megawatts by wind power would need territory roughly the size of Dartmoor. We're talking about 11 times that. So 11 Dartmoors would need to be covered to meet the 20% that Tony says we should aim to produce from wind power. It's a terrifying prospect, and they're going to put them in all the most beautiful parts of Britain. My final point is this. The world's nuclear power stations, at present operating, are reducing carbon dioxide emissions by the amount that the Kyoto Protocol seeks to reduce them. Without nuclear power, nuclear power is already giving us that carbon dioxide saving. If we abandon nuclear power, far from Kyoto reducing emissions, Kyoto would in fact increase them. So just be thoughtful. We're talking about keeping this country working, keeping it warm, keeping it livable. And Tony's talking about a series of totally undeveloped technologies which might make a contribution, but will not produce baseload power, which is what we need if we're going to keep the grid stable and people warm and comfortable.
Zach.
Yeah, just very quickly in response to the wind thing. I mean, the leading anti-wind farm organization in this country, despite its name, is called the Renewable Energy Foundation. Now, the Renewable Energy Foundation pretty much shares the target set by Greenpeace in terms of how much of our energy should be derived from wind power. They say 10%, Greenpeace is talking 15%, 16%, 17%, but it's not a million miles away. So those figures just, they don't add up at all. Just in response to what the lady up here said, I wish the decision was based on a respect for the markets, a respect for economics, because if it was, nuclear power would never have raised its head. The market has rejected nuclear power, despite what we've been told. It only exists by courtesy of massive subsidies and hidden costs across the board and in all kinds of very, very cunning ways. And it's not just the market that's rejected, and I've said this twice already, and I want to say it one more time, and I want to... that the insurance industry has rejected nuclear power as well. And I think that's crucial. The insurance industry has no interest in fabricating the fears or generating fears about nuclear power. A straight commercial decision that it's taken has led it to the conclusion that it would be too risky to insure nuclear power. For me, that's crucial. So don't listen to environmentalists, Friends of the Earth, myself, Michael, and so on, but the insurance industry, I think, ought to be listened to on this issue. Finally, the alternatives do exist, and they're not just wind farm. It's not nuclear versus wind. That's a fabricated debate. There are all kinds of alternatives there, and particularly the most exciting and the least controversial, and the one which we should be adopting now with great enthusiasm, is energy conservation. All the studies in relation to, and all the experiments in relation to energy conservation are incredibly impressive. For me, it's just a no-brainer. This is what we should do. We should embrace the alternatives. We should turn away from something which, in my view, is truly frightening.
Bishop Montefiore.
First, I would like to say something which hasn't been said, that people are not prepared to give up their standard of living voluntarily, and that is a basic fact you just have to take into account. It's no good saying, oh, people must give up this and that in order to make the planet safe. I have heard nothing that contradicts the arguments that I put forward. We need everything. Yes, conservation, as much conservation as we can get, as much renewables and nuclear power if we are to avoid global catastrophe. We must think of, we must be responsible for what we are leaving to those who come after us. And when it is said that only a quarter, electricity only accounts for only a quarter, bear in mind what will happen when fossil fuel gets very difficult. We are going to have a hydrogen economy. We will have to have fuel cells and a hydrogen economy. How is that hydrogen to be made? It must be made pollution-free, and it can be made from the electricity of nuclear energy. That is the vision for the future, and we must keep that in mind.
Michael Schneider.
Toby, could I have the screen, please, again? Is that possible?
I think, how many slides have you got?
Two, it's very fast.
Very fast.
It's much faster than if I...
Okay, let's go.
Okay, this is showing the situation, the development in France of the oil consumption in the various sectors, saying transports, residential and industrial sector, industry, etc. Now, the most interesting thing is this myth of the relationship between the oil consumption and nuclear power. You know that in 1974, the French government decided to launch a huge program, nuclear building program. And in fact, as you can see, this is the share of oil that has been used, less than 13% in 1973. Of the oil consumed in France was used to produce electricity. Now, the nuclear program comes in, and effectively, indeed, this share goes down to virtually nothing. However, does this lead to a radical decrease in the dependence on oil? By no means. In fact, what you can see is that the largest consumption share was already in 1973 was the transport sector. And the transport sector increased by far more than what was saved on the electricity side. So far to the dependence, the interdependence between oil and nuclear power. And here's the CO2 emissions, French CO2 emissions. Now we've heard nuclear power programs bring them down dramatically, don't they? Now, this is the curve of the evolution of CO2 emissions in France, and the yellow one is the energy sector. So indeed, it was reduced. Of course, it was reduced to some extent. But that's all. I mean, as after 1985, when what was happened is called the counter-oil shock, when the price went down, the consumption pattern was such that increased consumption led again to increased CO2 emissions.
Michael, thank you. We're going to, that is the 2 minutes, I'm afraid.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to have to. Thank you. Bruno.
Just a short comment on these last two slides. While France has decreased its energy consumption and CO2 emissions, it should be observed that in almost all other developed countries, over the same lapse of time, the consumption and the CO2 emissions have almost doubled in other countries. Now, as a conclusion, I would like to point out that we have only one planet and that it is fragile. It is our duty to make sure that the planet remains livable for our descendants and for future generations. 3 points. First, the key to our future is a clean and safe energy supply, which is available for all inhabitants of the planet, which isn't the case today. Second, well-designed, well-built, and well-operated nuclear power plants are safe, clean, and essential for the continuation of our civilization. Third, environmental opposition to nuclear energy by people such as Tony Juniper, Michael Schneider, and Zach Goldsmith will be recognized in the future as a major mistake and will be seen in time as an error of historic proportion. Ladies and gentlemen, we are all embarked on a ship. The ship is our planet. Because of our dependence on carbon fuels and because of climate change, human civilization, as we are very lucky to enjoy it today, is in danger of collapsing and disappearing. This means the ship is sinking, and we are in danger of drowning in the coming decades. We are very lucky that a solution, a real solution that works, really exists. It's nuclear energy. It takes 25 years to implement it, as France has shown. Fortunately, it is clean and it is safe. We already know that both climate change and our dependence on carbon fuel will come to dramatic situations in less than 25 years from now. So yes, it is very urgent that the whole world imitates France for the production of electricity as soon as possible in a clean manner. This, as Hugues Montefiore has stressed, means we can also increase energy efficiency and the renewable, but we are going to need absolutely everything. So
thank
yes,
you, Bruno.
Nuclear power must power our
future. Thank you very much, Bruno.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I just had a thought there, which was that as Bruno was talking about, you know, people in the future looking back and having and seeing what Zach and Tony are proposing as a major error, does that mean that they'll have won the argument if they see that it's a major error? I don't know, but for them to look back and think that means you would have to have won the argument. Just before I give you the result of the vote, can I just say that we have had very, very powerful arguments on both sides. I think you will agree that there have been some very, very fine speeches, the most wonderful array of facts and statistics and arguments and counter-arguments. It is therefore up to your very good sense to make up your own minds. I go back to what I said at the beginning. I think that all the signs are that this is going to be a major argument 6 months after the election. It's going to be on everyone's lips. The arguments you have heard today are going to be bandied back and forward by the politicians and by the people that were delighted to have joined us on the platform tonight. So don't forget, we in Intelligence Squared were the first to tell you. Okay, you heard it first here. Now, the debate result. For 289, against 224, the don't knows down to just 63. So what has happened is that the fours have gained about 30 votes. Those against have actually gained something like 70 votes, and the don't knows have shrunk from 186 to 63 by about 120 votes. So I formally declare that the ayes have it, that nuclear energy must power our future, is the decision from this Intelligence Squared debate. The next debate is on the 25th of May. The subject will be Putin. The subject will be Putin is the best hope for Russian liberalism. That's on the 25th of May. Thank you for joining us. Good night.